Hello friends, hi, this is Dr. Shonali Chandra, and today I will be discussing with you a small topic, which is endometrial polyps. So now let me share a screen with you here so we can look at the pictures together as we go along. All right, now endometrial polyps is an important cause of abnormal uterine bleeding in the reproductive age group. Okay, now what causes these endometrial polyps? Estrogen. Estrogen causes proliferation of the endometrium, and whenever there will be unopposed estrogen without the action of progesterone, without the stabilizing action of progesterone, then the proliferation can go on and on, and you know, it can lead to the development of endometrial polyps. So it is understandable that women who have anovulatory cycles, who have unopposed estrogen exposure because of that, who have irregular cycles, who have underlying infertility, these are the women who are more prone to developing endometrial polyps. And it is a condition which is more common in the reproductive age group. So what is the clinical presentation of endometrial polyp like? So we can have a look at the picture here on the left side and look at this. A number of polypoidal growths can be seen arising from the endometrium. All right. Now, these polypoidal growths are prone to bleeding. Now, mostly the endometrial polyps are asymptomatic, but when they do cause symptoms, they will cause abnormal bleeding, and they typically cause intermenstrual bleeding. What is intermenstrual bleeding? The woman will have her normal menses as usual, but somewhere in between, you know, off and on, she can have a few days of bleeding. Now, these endometrial polyps, these polypoidal growths, you know, they can have ulceration on their surface, inflammation, infection. So they are prone to bleeding in between menses. All right. So that is why they typically cause intermenstrual bleeding. They can also cause heavy menstrual bleeding, irregular bleeding, and they are also associated with tamoxifen use and infertility. Now, whenever a woman comes with a complaint of abnormal heavy menses or any kind of abnormal bleeding, like in this case, intermenstrual bleeding, the first thing that we do is to rule out any other structural cause. All right. So especially in reproductive age group women, we have to go for an ultrasound first to rule out a number of structural causes can be there. One of them is endometrial polyps. The other is, of course, our usual fibroids, uterus, the leiomyomas that we have know of, the adenomyosis, right, or endometrial hyperplasia. So these are the structural causes which need to be identified, and therefore we go for an ultrasound. Now, ultrasound, the normal grayscale ultrasound, will give us a suspicion of the diagnosis of endometrial polyp. So if we look at the figure here on the left, this is a grayscale ultrasound. And what we are seeing here is that the endometrium is quite thick. The endometrium is quite thick. And when we put color Doppler, we see that this small mass probably inside the endometrium, inside this thick endometrium, is getting feeded with a vessel. A vessel is actually feeding into this mass. And this is what we call as the feeding vessel sign, right? So the endometrium can be thick and irregular with vascular patterns of feeder blood vessels. Now, like we can appreciate in this figure here, is that the demarcation of the polypoidal mass is not very distinct, right? So to overcome that, we can use a saline infusion sonography or a sonohistrography. Now, what is a saline infusion sonography, friends? What we do is that inside the uterine cavity, saline is filled. Okay, we fill it with saline and then do the ultrasound. So what happens is this saline looks black. Okay, this line looks black on ultrasound, and any mass or lesion which is protruding inside the uterine cavity will then look very well demarcated, you know, across that black background. So cell line infusion sonography, it helps to visualize the intracavitary lesions better than the routine grayscale ultrasound. However, please also remember that the final diagnosis will be made by hysteroscopy, right? So the confirmation of the diagnosis will be done by hysteroscopy, as we can see with the figure here on the left topmost figure. Inside the uterus, we are seeing this polyp which is jutting into the uterine cavity. We can also see this feeding vessel. All right, so with hysteroscopy we are able to differentiate the endometrial polyp from an intracavitary fibroid, because an intracavitary fibroid is more fleshy in appearance because it is made up of muscle. Okay, it is a leiomyoma. However, endometrial polyp is not fleshy, okay? It is more friable, and obviously these feeding vessels will be seen. And the other very big advantage of hysteroscopy is that in the same sitting, we can also go for hysteroscopic resection. So what we'll do is we will resect this endometrial polyp, take it out, right? And send it for histopathological examination. And it is on that histopathological examination that final confirmation will arrive that yes, the tissue resected is indeed an endometrial polyp. Okay, so the final confirmation of diagnosis is done by hysteroscopy, and obviously we can have the diagnosis and the treatment with hysteroscopy in the same setting, right? So what we did with this resection is that we treated the immediate structural lesion, right? We just removed the structural lesion, but we've not dealt with the cause, friends, right? So understand that when I told you in the beginning that the cause is obviously unopposed estrogen exposure, and there is a tendency of this endometrium in this particular woman to organize itself into polypoidal growths. So what we need to do now after treating her lesion is give her something that will make her endometrium thin and not allow these endometrial polyps to recur. And one thing that we can do for her is Mirena insertion. Yes, friends, Mirena is a levonorgestrel containing intrauterine device, and we put it inside the uterine cavity. It releases levonorgestrel. It can be left there for a period of 5 years, right? 5 to 7 years, it can be left there inside. And what this Mirena does, it makes the endometrium thin, very, very thin, right? Because of the progesterone effect. And the woman is relieved of her symptoms for a longer duration of time, right? So that is how we are going to approach the treatment of endometrial polyp. All right, so friends, this is the discussion on an important topic, endometrial polyp, and I hope you like this video. You can also follow me on the Telegram channel with the link provided below. And if you have any suggestions regarding the content and cases that you want to be discussed, please feel free to share your suggestions in the comment section below. Thank you.